Thank you for the opportunity to present. I am not an active participant of such a discussion, maybe evolution and tumor, because I do not have my own data or my own ideas. I work in a slightly different area. An hour ago, I presented my topic at a different symposium. That was one of the slides from that presentation of mine. The probability of cancer growth with the aging, even though we may have some deviations in terms of various localizations or types, but we have a correlation which is linear. Cancer rate to age. Overall mortality in people, but even in E. coli bacteria. The only difference is that we have 120 years for human beings and 120 days for E. coli. Aging and carcinogenesis are fundamentally interconnected, and that's why this interdependence exists. The essence of this hypothesis is that the probability of cancer increases with aging, not because the mutation load increases, but because the conditions within the organism change in such a way that the selection of phenotypical variants is stabilized during the young period, while with aging it moves towards malignancy. Not my idea, by the way. But if you deal with this topic, you have to follow the publications dedicated to cancer and evolution. And I would like to share some of the things I've managed to fish out from the publications. The domineering idea is that tumors took part in the evolution, and there was a publication that showed that the first multicellular organisms were tumor-like organisms with low differentiation. And the idea of their existence was that the death caused by them was replenished by the development of other organisms, and the main goal was a very specific behavior of quicker replication of the new organisms. And we see that this behavior resembles the behavior of very aggressive tumors a lot. So tumors behave very much like antediluvian organisms. And one of the aspects of these primary tumors was restriction of own growth, because you can't grow forever, you have to regulate this somehow. And when, thanks to therapeutic impacts, the majority of tumor cells are killed, the restriction is elevated from growth of the most malignant cells. And this idea that cancer cells have to be destroyed is a bad idea, because it leads to the fact that, well, it actually gives rise to mets. One way or other, the behavior of cancer cell population resembles the behavior of multicellular organisms many, many years or millennia ago. So it's a kind of an atavism. And Otto Warburg effect is considered to be one of these options of going back in evolution. Hence, lots of very interesting questions. The most interesting one is, what form of life are cancer cells representing? In the process of evolution, they may become a separate form of life. Which we may see, for example, in Tasmanian wolf or some mollusks. They adapt to their environment and form a new form of the organism. In connection with this, there was an article that came out quite recently. Infectious cancer was a factor of evolution of multicellular organisms. Some cells that misbehaved were extremely dangerous, while the idea was, the main idea is to limit such uncontrollable things. Next comes the question, why, despite the a lot of genetic rearrangements and the long list of oncogenes, the malignant phenotype is so paradoxically stereotyped in all cancers. And another one. And are there characteristics of the malignant phenotype? And we are talking about malignant growth. These are the results of full genome, the whole genome, sorry, actually the name of the article was Whole Genome Panorama of Cancer Drivers. The size here is reflects the incidence of these genes in the human tumors. But there are some clusters not dependent of this. Malignant cells that are formed in various initial conditions as a result of various mutations, but they, at the end of the day, may come down to the same tumor phenotype. And the answer may be very simple. It is called ambient evolution. But in the real evolution, several millions of years were needed, but here usually it takes the duration of this process is about 10 years. Even quicker in mice, several months. How this convergence happens so quickly? The assumption is that there's no convergence, but a kind of a gestalt of gene networks exists that is characteristic of cells and maybe in some animals, but when we have cancer transformation, certain restrictions are lifted. And after this, we have a demon comes out of the box, and thus we have the tumor-like changes. Back to the authors of this work. They say we have a certain pattern of play cards face down. When we open them first, no order is seen, but when sufficient cards are turned face up, we see that there is a specific order in which they are sequenced. And the authors thus explain that after a series of mutations, the organisms come to a set of features specific for specific cells. These ideas became a stimulus for phylostratigraphic analysis. It started with this work. The authors have taken the genes from several databases where the number of oncogenes or the genes one way or other connected with tumor growth. And these were the genes selected based on various criteria. And then the origin of these genes was connected to different events that happened in the course of the evolution of life on Earth, starting from the very beginning. And the assumption was as follows: if the genes that mutated in various ways, if the time of their formation is evenly distributed on their time scale, then for the genes that qualified as oncogenes, the distribution will be even like this. But it was shown that the majority of the genes allocated to the number of genes connected with the tumor growth based on various factors, and the genes selected from various databases created based on various criteria, but the maximum was allocated to this time. When there was a transition from single cell organisms to multiple cell organisms. Carrying on here, these genes we have the same picture as on the previous slide. Well, here the same is shown for oncogenes and suppressor genes, and we see the same spike of both at the level where single cell organisms were replaced by multiple cells organisms. Next, another work in which phylostratigraphic analysis was carried out, and it was shown that the majority of genes are formed when we pass over from eukaryota to metazoa. And the trend is as follows. Without going much into detail, all this works actually. Stress out the same things. Here we also have works conducted with the help of other methods and other conditions, but the conclusion was practically the same. One of the modes of existence of both eukaryotic and primary monokaryotic organisms was the response to stress conditions. Some of the variants thus were able to survive and thus promote the new generations. And one of the variants of this genotype's diversity, both in bacterial cells but also in the primordial multi-eukaryotes, was cancellation of reparation. DNA reparation is very labor-intensive, effort-intensive process, and becomes much too costly a process in such conditions. So all the resources were aimed to proliferation at the expense of this process. And this mechanism works in bacteria, in eukaryotic organisms, and in metazoan. Organisms, and most probably in cancer cells as well, because it was shown that most often the mutations take place in the younger genes, which was mentioned before. The younger genes are mutated in tumors more often. And also in the tumors, the level of expression of these DNA polymerase is increased. These polymerase in the stress conditions, it goes through the damaged regions of the DNA, includes what is needed into the chain, and thus the cells can evolve in the conditions of therapeutic action. It was also shown that the suppression of this DNA polymerase leads to the synthesis to sensitization of drug-resistant lung tumors to chemotherapy. Human thought moves forward. Some people think that cancer may be considered in this universal perspective, but this is the next stage. I'm not going to do this now. Thank you. And once again, I have no data of my own. Thank you very much. I have three questions. How would you explain? You say that cancer is imminent. Well, Davis shows that 600 million years ago, cancer was zero. I do not know, but I do. Probably you have to replace cancer by tumor. The tumors may characterize the beginning of life. No, or most probably vice versa. There is no such a thing as primitive cancer. There are primitive tumors, but not primitive cancer. The tumors behave like primordial low differentiated organisms because first they can exist, because they manage to proliferate before all of them die. And one of the mechanisms for survival of population are the genetic diversity, is the genetic diversity. But the Moscow State University, I had a work that shown that the tumor cells give rise to new species even. A very interesting work, a very interesting study, but a slightly different branch of evolution. Another question. You give stratigraphic data that are controversial to our data. No, they are not. I know they are not, but you explain it in such controversial way. No, they are not controversial. You said that the main peak happens somewhere between eukaryotic and metazoan organisms. Such stratigraphic analysis is based on the domains analysis, not the genes, while we analyze the genes. That's why domains happen very early, while genes happen much later. I'm not going to enter this discussion because I have to know more about the methods. And last but not least, you say that younger genes are underrepresented. This coincides completely with what we've demonstrated today. Oncogenes and tumor suppressors are the older classes of human genes after housekeeping genes. I want to draw your attention to another circumstance. There is a flow of thought, cumulative thought, around the works of Andrei Petrovich and his team. While these people had a starting point for the development of their theory and notions and their studies, and they have their own community. Their community does not quote the works of your community and vice versa. What is interesting? Most probably the evolution is quicker when there are several small populations that exist independently of each other, but then they start to interact. There's a very interesting thing there. After I presented in the National Cancer Institute, they organized this program you're telling about. That's the Anglo-Saxon disease, you know. While the book that you've given, I wrote a peer review to this book.